It is difficult putting God first all the time. It is difficult maintaining that relationship with God all the time. But it says that we need to persevere. And you know, during this race, the first 3 or 4 miles, everyone's all jolly and saying, yeah, we're doing the London Marathon. You're looking at each other, shouting out each other's names because it's on people's backs. Things like, where's John? He's in front of you. But then you're on the 6th mile, then the 7th mile, and then the 13th mile. And 13 is okay, but then you get to a point where you're thinking, I'm getting tired. I don't know if I can continue doing this. And it's like that with the Christian walk. Because sometimes we go into desert times where we are going through a wilderness and we don't know why we're going through it, but we're going through it.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website, you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts. Today's program is called Strip Down, Start Running, and Never Quit, Hebrews chapter 12 by Evangelist Steve Williams.
I'm going to talk about last weekend. For those of you who don't know, last weekend I attempted to run the London Marathon. I say the word attempted. And I completed it. Last weekend, Warren spoke from Hebrews chapter 12, which I'm speaking about this morning, but he looked at the whole area of discipline. Well, I'm looking at the whole area of running, funny enough. I don't know why, but I think I should do that this week. And what I want to do is take away from last weekend, or the last year where I've been training, different aspects of my journey training for the marathon, which I'm doing again next year, by the way, if anyone wants to join me. All of you, excellent. Can you imagine in a year's time, no one's at church this morning. They're all running the marathon. Maybe not. But I'll be looking at aspects from the marathon and looking at it from a biblical perspective, looking at Hebrews chapter 12. So hopefully we'll go through that in a quick pace. Do you like the pun there? If you turn to Hebrews chapter 12, it is page 1210, the Church Bible. And it says this. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great crowd of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted the point of shedding your blood, and you have forgotten that word of encouragement that addresses your son, you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes everyone except as a son. Right, just briefly, let me ask you a quick question. In this life we're living, where do you stand with God? Where do you stand with God? Do you have a relationship with him? Do you have a situation where you come to church on a Sunday, go home later on, and things aren't much different to what it was 2 hours before that? Where are you with God? When I was about 21, I was pretty fit, I would say, in the physical terms, not from that point of view, the other fit. Wendy thought so. Can you stand up, please? This hair is my wife. It's not just anyone just saying out, I think so. Though that could be the case. No, I won't even go there. But she's been my support, and I hopefully have been a support to her for the last 25, 30 odd years we've known each other. Is it 25? Okay. It seems like 30 anyway. Right, okay. Just don't go there. I'm in trouble now. But when I was about 21, I used to work out up in the loft in my parents' house. I used to do weights every other day. I used to run about 3 or 4 miles. And, you know, I used to be very fit in terms of in physical shape. But what happened, I sort of got out of the habit of being fit. Life got busy. I kept on doing things in church, which is great. I kept on doing things within work. That was great. I had a social life. I met Wendy. That was even greater. Another house point for later on.
It's too late now,
John, isn't it? But then I thought about getting back into shape again. And, you know, I started playing squash, which I lost at every time. And I'd done that for a few hours, for a couple of weeks, and that stopped. It was fads. Fads of exercise. Fads of exercise. Nothing sort of substantial. It didn't mean anything. It didn't do anything. But when I was about 39, 40, I took my daughters swimming. I've got two daughters, Heather and Holly. In fact, if you look behind you, they're washing up. We went swimming together. And they said, Dad, Dad. I said, yes, yes. Let's have a race in the pool.
Of course we will.
Yes. And, you know, being the father I am, I let them beat me. No, I didn't let them beat me. They beat me anyway. I realised how unfit I was. I realised how out of shape I was. In fact, I was 3 stone heavier than what I am now. In fact, these bags here of sugar represent that, of how much I weighed then to how much I weigh now. That was only 3.5 years ago. And the reason why I'm sharing that is, you know, those of us who are thinking or contemplating the Christian life are very similar to that picture I drew out there of me and exercise. You know, I had loads of people saying to me, Steve, look at you. You need to lose a bit of weight. Steve, look at you. You need to get fit because when you get old, you won't be able to do certain things. And I took notice after a while. It took quite a long time before I'd done anything about it. But it's the same with the Christian walk, with this run with God. You see, you may be contemplating committing yourself to God. And your words in your head may be, yes, tomorrow, yes, tomorrow, yes, tomorrow. Like it was with me when it came to getting fit. But you know, you can only have so many tomorrows. You can only have so many tomorrows. So my question to you is this. As you go in your journey for life, don't wait till tomorrow to put God first. Do it today. It's not an easy race. I've done the marathon, but the greatest marathon is running for Jesus. Because that marathon has joyful times. That marathon has times where there's hardship and difficulties. That marathon, you want to give up and not believe anymore because it's so hard sometimes. But along that way, in that marathon of life with Jesus, you have God's Spirit within you, allowing you and equipping you to do the things He's calling you to do. So my question is to you, don't be a spectator. Don't be someone coming here on a Sunday, just singing a few songs, reading a few bits of scripture from a book called the Bible. Don't just say a few prayers. Give yourself to this man, Jesus, who can change your life, and get on the track. Because some of you are on the sidelines. And this race, we need runners. And this race is not a sprint. It's a marathon. You've got to pace yourself. And you've got to be where God wants you to be in this race. Here amongst you, you'll see some running shoes. A shirt, a pair of shorts, socks, all good running gear. I could put it on today, now, if you want me to. But it's meaningless if I'm just walking around in the house in it, which I do most of the time, rather than going out on the streets and training and running. And my question is to you, are you actually running for God at this moment in time? Watch the mic stand. Or are you just on the side there, watching, spectating, and us watching people run past who are enjoying God? And you may have questions about where you are with God. But let me say something to you. It's the hardest decision to get off that sideline and run that race. But it is what you've been made for. It's what you've been made for. Exactly that. I better start talking about what I was going to talk about. Acts 2:38 says this. Repent, believe, and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. And then you will receive the Holy Spirit. Many of you have done that, but some of you haven't done that. And I thought it'd be good just to mention this, that for us to start this race, we need to allow Him into our lives, Jesus. We need to be baptized, and we also need to be turning around from the life we live and putting Him first. Most of you may have done that, but some of you, you need to start by doing that. And that gets you on the track itself to start running. And later on, there'll be an opportunity for you to commit yourself to that. Right, let's go to this passage, shall we? This passage starts off with such a crowd of witnesses. Let us take off everything which hinders. And in Hebrews chapter 11, it gives us a list upon a list upon a list of all these people of God who've been through a relationship with God, where they've experienced God, where they've been promised things by God and God has delivered every time, where they've been going through difficulties in life and God has delivered every time. And that is the crowd of witnesses which is mentioned here, which is in Hebrews chapter 11. And you know what? Last week, I was running this race, okay? And at about the 17th mile, I had a problem. So I've got some water from the water station. There's water stations throughout this race. And I walked, first of all, a few minutes, and then my whole of my leg seized up. All my legs seized up because of, when you explain it, you know, something about acids building up in your legs when you after you exercise. And I couldn't run anymore for a period of time. So I had to walk as quickly as I can. And eventually I got going again. But on my shirt was my name. You can see Steve at the back at the front. There was probably 35,000 runners. Along the side were thousands upon thousands upon thousands of witnesses, spectators watching you run. And as you was running, people were shouting out, "Go on, Steve! Go on! Run! Go for it! Go for it!" Even though I was, because you're standing there. You go for it. That's what you think in your head. Okay. And they got their barbecues going over there as well. Okay. And, you know, they're encouraging you to spur on. And there's other runners running behind you going, "Come on, get on, go for it, go for it." And you know what? It was great in two ways. One, I was able to walk quite fast. And I was able to speak to people about Jesus when I was walking. Funny enough, I was saying to myself, "Who can I speak to while I'm walking this particular pace?" Because you can't speak to people when you're running. And there was four or five people I was able to speak to. I'll tell you how easy it was. "What are you running for?" "The church." Got into a conversation with about four or five people, and that was great. But the reason why I'm sharing this is this, is that we have these witnesses in Hebrews written down here, yeah? In which we can look back on and say, look, God has turned up for these people time and time and time again. We in this room here, some of us may be going through difficulties in what we're going through in our life today, and we're finding a struggle to persevere, to move on where we are with God. And what God's saying to you is two things. Look at the experiences of your past, your personal experience of your past, how I have turned up and touched you in situations of difficulty. It may be financial situations, it may be personal problems, but each time if we call on him, he turns up. Isn't that right, church? And secondly, look at these people in Hebrews chapter 11. Because it is documented in the Bible how I have turned their situations around and made bad things good and made promises come true. And you know what? He's made promises to people in this room. And you're thinking, when's it going to happen? It's going to happen. If he's promised you something, it's going to happen. And there's a proof of it with these witnesses in Hebrews chapter 11. Amen. But think about sin. Think about the things in our lives which entangle us and how that will put you in bondage, how that will make you in a situation where you're not walking with God, you're basically on the sidelines. And, you know, there's loads of baggers of sugar there. And God reveals to us a bit at a time things which need addressing in our lives. He doesn't necessarily do it straight away all at once. And as he takes each situation away from us, we are freed up even more. We're equipped even more. But we've got to be open to God even more because we want to take off everything which entangles us. And by the way, the athletes of ancient times, do you know what they used to wear? Any idea? Nothing. Nothing. The London Marathon, there were people who had clothes on, don't worry. They used to take off everything. So anything which would be a hindrance was taken off. And we need to be asking God, in my life today, is there anything which I need to remove because it is causing a hindrance between you and me, Father. It's causing a hindrance between me and my fellow brothers and sisters. Small or big, it's still a hindrance. And we are experiencing growth in this church. Now, I can tell you what, the first thing the enemy will try and do is destroy relationships, is cause bitterness between fellow brothers and sisters. And we need to be on our guard
that we do not fall for that trap, which will be thrown upon us at some point. But we need to put these things to bed quickly so we can run that race and be effective in the race we have with God. Amen. Amen. Let's carry on, shall we? Now, if I say the word perseverance, what does that bring up to you? Can I have some answers, please? Perseverance, what comes to mind? Gosh, they're keen over here. There's people in this corner here, by the way, if you can't see them.
Determination.
Determination.
Strive to do better.
To strive to do better. Anita.
Continuing to keep going for God.
Continuing to keep going for God. This is a mouth in itself, isn't it?
Just keep on trying.
Keep on trying. Well, one or two more.
Keep going until you've succeeded.
Keep going until you've succeeded.
Endurance.
Endurance. Right, that'll do. Quite a few words there. There we go. Back up there. Hey, that's a small little one. Right, now. Running this race, when you first become a Christian, there's that first joy, there's that first excitement in which you you want to tell people what you've done. You want to say to people, this has happened in my life. God has come into my life. When you read the accounts in the New Testament, people get healed, they go and tell everyone about it. And that's great. But the thing about it is difficult putting God first all the time. It is difficult maintaining that relationship with God all the time. But it says that we need to persevere. And, you know, during this race, the first 3 or 4 miles, everyone's all jolly and saying, yeah, we're doing the London Marathon. You're looking at each other, shouting out each other's names because it's on people's backs. Things like, where's John? He's in front of you. But then you're on the 6th mile, then the 7th mile, and then the 13th mile. And 13 is okay, but then you get to a point where you're thinking, I'm getting tired. I don't know if I can continue doing this. And it's like that with the Christian walk. Because sometimes we go into desert times where we are going through a wilderness and we don't know why we're going through it, but we're going through it. But, you know, when I'm running, I use a thing called a heart rate monitor. Because the heart rate monitor, which I've got on now, hold on, let's have a look, 92. Right, the heart rate monitor tells you what your heart is doing. And what it means is that when you're running, you may feel tired, but the true judgment of what your body is doing is what the heart rate monitor says. If you're overexerting yourself, which I know that if I'm running at 170 beats per minute, I'm overexerting myself. If I'm doing 160 to 165, I'm okay. I know I'm not overexerting myself. So when I feel that I'm tired, some of it is actually your mind playing tricks with you. Because when you run that amount of time, that distance, there's a lot of mental things going on in your mind where it's saying to you, you can't go any further, you can't go any further. And what you've got to do, you've got to push through because you know what the truth is. And it's the same with our relationship with God. We're going through difficulties in life. We're going through hardships in life. And we've got to persevere and push through. Because we know there is a constant. We know there is something faithful, someone faithful out there who doesn't matter what we're going through, he's constantly there for us. And that is Jesus Christ. You won't find that anywhere else. He is the constant person in our life, which is constantly true, which is constantly putting us in the right frame, in the right track in life. And as long as we're with him, doesn't matter how we feel, we know he's under control. And we'll try and do things in our own way. And time and time again, it goes wrong. But when we persevere and allow the King who created this world to be the centre of what we're doing, despite what we're feeling, despite where we are, we know when we look back at history, we know when we look back in time, he is constant. So like his heart rate monitor, I know that though my mind is saying I'm tired, I can push through it and move on. And we know, though things may be difficult, though you may feel like we've been sidelined, even though I may have a little twinge in my leg, we can move on. And we've got to pace ourselves to God's pace, not our own pace. I went about a week and a half ago, I just done my last small run before the marathon. It was only 3 miles, and I took John with me. Where's John? Is he here somewhere? Is Joe over there? John's 22. Is it 22, John? Sorry? Oh, you're 20. It makes it even better, this story. John's 20, and I'm a bit older. And I'm 44, 45, June the 9th. June the 9th, yeah? Remember that. Right, now, I said to John, we're just going to do a 3 mile run up to Nafala Fields, up the little circular hill, and back down again and back home. So I said, let's pace yourself. Okay, all right. So I started doing my little run. He's running backwards like this. Come on, Steve. Come on, Steve. You're just walking, I'm running. Let's pace yourself. Okay, right, so I kept my pace. Halfway through, John said to me, I've got a stitch. I can't run anymore. I can't run anymore. I goes, well, it's tough, isn't it? Because I'm running back on my own now. So the thing about it is you've got to pace yourself. And the way we pace ourselves is not what we want to do, but what God wants to do through us. And so often we do things under our own strength, when we should be doing things under God's strength and God's power and God's ability. So we need to be asking ourselves, the things I'm doing today, like these stone visits, which Warren spoke about last week, am I in the right place in church this moment in time? Am I in the right place in the things I'm doing? Because it says further on that we are running a race which is marked out for us. Now, as a church, we have a race marked out for us and where God wants us to go. But also, as individuals, we have a race marked out for us where God wants us to go. And it's up for us to actually allow God in and to ask him, where do you want me to go in this race? Each of you is being marked out. And each of you need to be going through that route where God wants you to go. During this marathon, you're given a digital chip which goes on your shoe so they can track where you've been. You're tempted to go on the tube, you know that. So you're running along thinking, there's a tube station over there. Should I just pop on a tube? Well, what you could do is that you can give your chip to another runner who's faster than you. No, don't do that. But you often you're running this race and you're thinking, you know, I could go another route. I could just take my shirt off and mingle with the crowd and sort of give up. But God knows everything where you've been. That chip tells the marathon head office where you ran. And if you deviated or used any special means, i.e. London Transport, to get to the other end. And you know what? We need to look at ourselves from two points of view. A spiritual point of view, where we are spiritually with God, and a physical point of view, where we are locational-wise as well. Because God knows where you're meant to be. God knows what you're thinking. There's no hiding place from God. Like a GPS chip, they know where you've been. God knows exactly what you're thinking, exactly where you're going through in life. He wants purity from his children. And he wants you to be in the right path, in the right places, whether that's your job, whether that's your home, whether that is where you are in terms of the things you're doing in church. So the question is to you is, in this race marked out of you, you need to ask yourself, the things I'm doing today, Father, the things, am I on the right track? Am I in the right journey in terms of where I am in terms of this race? Amen. And you know what? God gives us direction in life and which ways we to go, which way we are to go. And it may be through people, it may be through the church, but he will show you which way to go. If we go our own way, there will be consequences to pay. I've got a letter here. It says penalty notice. It's addressed to Mrs. Wendy Ann Williams. Okay. Now, a couple of weeks ago, I'm going to tell you a little story here. We do make mistakes sometimes. Right, I was driving down Curry Road. You know who knows Curry Road in Greenford? And the bottom of Curry Road, I didn't notice it, but my wife shouted out to me, Steve, Steve, there's no right turn here. It was too late by then, because I was...
No, that's not true.
Okay, it's not true. There's no right... Can you leave at this moment in time? Right. I want to tell my story, darling. Right, there's no right turn here. 12:15. There's no right turn here. And I said, my car was positioned to turn right, so I turned right anyway, didn't I? Silly me, I shouldn't have done that. He said to me, there's no cameras there. So I drove back and saying, there's no cameras there. 2 weeks later, this came up. With a picture of some, it's meant to be a grey car, but I think it's sort of dirty grey now. But that's because I didn't follow the signs marked out for me properly. And that's the consequence. It's a penalty charge. But... thank you. You're going to pay it? Timmy. Thanks, Timmy. Okay. I just want to thank the church for paying my penalty charge. Thanks, Timmy. Thank you. It's 60 quid, or it's 120 if you're not paid in 14 days. Thank you. Right. But similarly, in our walk with God, God's got he's got our route marked out for us where we should be. And if we go in other directions, we're not under the umbrella of his love. We're not under the umbrella of experiencing him. And then through that, what happens? There's even more hardship, there's even more difficulties, and there's even a penalty charge of 60 quid sometimes if you drive incorrectly as well. But that's what I mean. We need to be watching where we are and asking God to make sure we're in the right track. Now, some of you are younger than me out there. Some of you are a bit older than me. Some of you may be a bit more older than me. Some of you may be a bit more younger than me. But during this marathon, there were teenagers, there were 70-year-olds, there were 80-year-olds, there were from people from different nationalities, different backgrounds, all running this race. But one thing I realised, doesn't matter how old these people were or how young these people were, they were able to go through this race and do this race. Some of these people in their 70s were quite close to the winner's times. That's how incredible some of these runners were. People running in 2.5 hours, these half the time I'd done it in their 70s. The reason why I'm sharing this to you is do not allow your age, whether you're young or old, determine what you can do for God. Because you can do anything with the power of God. These witnesses we read about in Hebrews spells that out. You may have physical disabilities. You may have issues because of your age. With God, you can fly like an eagle. Those of you who are older, those of you who are younger, you young folk may think you can do anything you want to. You older folk think you can do hardly anything. But let me say something to you. You younger folk need to slow down, and you older folk need to speed up, because you can do anything through Jesus, because he's equipped you. And when you look at the stories of the Old Testament, when you look at the stories of the New Testament, you see how older folk are doing incredible things for God because he's equipped them and he's empowered them. And some of you are finding it hard to persevere. You're thinking, I can't do this anymore because I'm too old. I shouldn't be doing this because I'm too young. And the thing about it is this. There's no age when you can't do anything for God. Because he wants to use you and equip you. Persevere. Persevere. Now, one of the things which caused a problem for me was this pain I was going through on the 17th mile. And in Galatians, it talks about a run where we've been hindered by the enemy. And, you know, we need to be on our guard, because while running this race, there's a force in power which doesn't want you to succeed. And I want to talk about another race. In yacht racing, there is a point where two yachts are racing against each other, or there'll be more yachts, but it is catching the other yacht's wind. And what it means is, I can't explain it properly because I've got a mic in my hand, is that your opposition will place his boat in a certain place where it catches the wind and your sail loses the wind. And thus, that boat steams past you and you lose the power from your sails. And often, the enemy will do anything he can to cut into our race, to hinder us. And I just want to briefly say, we want to be on our guard for this. We want to be on our guard for this, that we are ready for these battles and allowing God to be the center of what we're doing, so he cannot hinder us in this race. Here amongst me, I have a few things. And one of the great prizes at the end is this solid platinum Flora London Marathon 2009 medal. And I tell you what, when you run, when it got to the last few miles, I sprinted the last 2 miles. I got my energy back again. And the reason why I was able to do that was two things. This belt had great things on it to help me. These gels boost up your energy levels. When you're running a race of such a long distance, at about the 20th mile, you lose everything in your body which you've eaten over the last 3 days. Because basically you run out of energy. And you hit this thing called the wall, where you can't run any further. You can't go any further. But to help me get past that situation, I took 12 of these energy banana things. And they topped me up every half a mile. And the reason why I'm saying that is this. We need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. We need to be touched by the Holy Spirit. As we go on in life, we empty ourselves out. We need to be constantly, constantly drinking from His fountain, that we are constantly, constantly filled and equipped. If we don't do that, we're going to be doing things under our own strength and doing our own thing. Just lastly, the key to me completing that marathon was focus. And the question I want to ask you is where is your focus? Because it says here, we need to be focused on Jesus. If we're focused on Jesus, our sights will be set at the right person. If we're focused on anything else, we'll be distracted. To help me focus during my race, I had my iPod. And in my iPod, I had worship music playing. And I tell you what, it helped me do two things. Focus on God. And I tell you what, people are going, what's he singing about? Right. But also, it got my mindset. I was able to worship God while I was running. And during the training particularly. And it helped me focus on the race at the same time. And you know what? Every moment in life, we need to find ways to focus in God and not get distracted. And this is for me. I need to do this. We all need to do this. And so often, we focus on the wrong things. I need to focus on Him and find Him in every moment I can. Whether it's through reading the Bible, whether it's through praying, whether it's through worship, but find Him in every aspect of life, whether it's the workplace, whether it's at home, whether it's the bus stop. We need to be focused on Him and set our minds on Him. And when we do that, you know what happens? Things happen. Miraculous things happen. Because as we focus on God, God uses us. As we are used by God, things happen. People's lives are changed. And we finish this race eventually. Amen. Let's stand, shall we? I just want you to think for a few moments of where you are with God. Some of you may have bought yourself a Bible, you may be reading it, but it doesn't make you a Christian. Some of you need to make that first step of allowing God in your life and being baptized. Others of you have been sidelined and need to get back on track again in this race. Others of you are finding it a struggle to persevere due to life's pressures. Some of you just need to turn your eyes to the right place and get yourself back into focus again.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.